Thank you. Jesus said to his disciples, "Amen, amen, I say to you, you will weep and mourn while the world rejoices. You will grieve, but your grief will become joy. When a woman is in labor, she is in anguish because her hour has arrived. But when she has given birth to a child, she no longer remembers the pain because of her joy, that a child has been born into the world. So you also are now in anguish. But I will see you again, and your hearts will rejoice, and no one will take your joy away from you. On that day, you will not question me about anything. Amen, amen, I say to you, whatever you ask the Father in my name, he will give you." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus.
My friends, on this beautiful morning, as the sun streams in and lasts through the windows of the basilica, and the spring rains have finished for the moment, as we come to the end of another academic year, everyone is relieved. We are thankful for the blessings of the past 9 months, and we reflect, I hope peacefully, on the lessons learned over that time. Since August, we have worked hard together, endeavored to grow spiritually, striven to be good stewards of our God-given talents, collaborated on projects, relaxed together, enjoyed each other's company, avoided each other's company, agreed at times, disagreed at times, in some a lot of water has passed under the bridge. For me, it was, of course, my first year as the rector of the seminary, and for some of you, it was the first year in formation here at St. Vincent as well. Others among you have been here longer and have seen growth and change in this school of the Lord's service as much as they have seen it in themselves. This is all well and good. As John Henry Newman once said, to live is to change, and to be perfect is to have changed often. The days and years ahead promise many more changes for us, and we must face these waves of change prudently. Both the smooth crests that carry us to ever newer life in the Spirit and growth in our respective vocations, and the white caps that buffet and pummel us and seem to threaten our aims and our peace. My friends, our society longs for leaders who will help direct it toward a credible engagement with the perennial questions that rise up in the human heart and the particular difficulties and conflicts of our times. Here, we can all make a contribution, shaped and molded by the faith in God which we hold in common and which we seek to share with others. At the same time, our modern culture is one that is capable of powerfully opposing the saving word of Christ which we find in the gospel. And we need to be prepared for this as well as we all go our separate ways. There is no need to be daunted by this challenge, however. In the Gospel himself, Jesus addresses this point, saying, "So you also are now in anguish, but I will see you will give you. As we mark the ascension over the next 10 or so days, we realize that Jesus has departed physically from us, yet he is present with us spiritually and sacramentally as we address the season of change ahead of us. He will return and bring his work to completion. In the meantime, friends, we are to be his eyes, ears, hands, and feet. This means taking to the highways and hedgerows, beginning the good work of seeking to bring about conversion and transformation in our society, as surely as we take up the work of conversion ourselves here in the seminary. So I say to each one of you this day, what the Lord said to St. Paul in Corinth when he appeared in a vision, do not be afraid. Go on speaking and do not be silent, for I am with you. To the men who will soon be ordained, I say, do not be afraid. You are beginning a new phase in your life as deacons and priests, ministers of the gospel which calls all to salvation. Give that one most precious possession you have, your faith in Christ, to the people entrusted to your care, and find in them the very image of the one whom you proclaim. To those who are advancing to the next year of priestly formation, I say, do not be afraid. The challenges you have faced and continue to face are not insuperable. And with the help of many friends, classmates, teachers, and mentors, you can and will move forward toward that service which you seek as a minister of Christ and his good news. To those who are departing from the seminary and moving forward into a new stage in life, seeking to make the gospel resound in the world and to sanctify the realm of the secular, I say, do not be afraid. Take the lessons and the growth that you encounter here at St. Vincent's with you as you enter new areas of endeavor, always holding fast to your primordial vocation as a disciple of Jesus. To those who have supported St. Vincent Seminary over this past year through their prayers and generosity, I say, do not be afraid. Your support is deeply appreciated and is being stewarded well by the staff and faculty of the seminary. This is seen most clearly in the dedicated work and the noble spirit of the seminarians who benefit from your kindness. To all my collaborators in the vineyard of the Lord, our faculty and staff, and the clergy of the diocese and communities that we serve, I say, do not be afraid. We live in a time when the cultural view of religious practice is rapidly changing, and new obstacles to belief have arisen in our midst. By standing firm in our faith in Jesus Christ, who is changeless yet ever new, we have all the hope and conviction we need to carry out our work of seminary formation with joy. Joy that no one can take from us, as Jesus says in the Gospel. Knowing that the one who strengthened St. Paul in his moments of weakness will do the same always for us. My friends, everyone present here has a role to play in God's infinitely wise plan for the salvation of his children. Heeding the counsel delivered to Paul by the Lord himself, we turn away from any tendency to be afraid of what confronts us, and we go on speaking with the assurance of those who know that the risen and ascended Lord is with us and sustains us in our every effort. Earlier, I noted that the great English convert and apologist John Henry Newman wrote, "In a higher world, it is otherwise, but here below, to live is to change, and to be perfect is to have changed often." He meant that no one can claim perfection this side of heaven, and that constant and even painful change is necessary for everyone who follows the path of Christian discipleship. Often, writers who quote Newman forget, or never knew in the first place, that he prefaced those remarks on change with an important statement that qualifies them. He said, "Things change in order to remain the same." That is, things change to remain true to themselves. Remaining true to ourselves and our mission, it is the theological virtue of hope, present abundantly among God's people in these holy days of Ascension time, which enable us to forge ahead and renew the spirit of joy and gladness that gave meaning to each one of us as we embark on our vocations as Christians, and which will carry us forward to bring that same joy and peace to all those whom we serve together as stewards of the gospel of Jesus Christ.
For our Holy Father, Pope Francis, Edward, our Bishop, Archbishop Douglas, and all the clergy, that they may lead the Church with true wisdom and pastoral charity, we praise the Lord.
Thank you. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread and, giving thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me."
Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb.